rescue women and children from sex slave trafficking. If you want to give into that, write Rescue Life on your envelope, and we'll continue to send it to them. Now I'm not moving at all. There we go. Remember, Beamer sessions are sold in the bookstore. You can buy as many sessions as you want. $5 for regular attenders, $10 for non, and then free to all of our veterans, whether they come to church or they do not attend church here, but mention it to them. Happy birthday. We have one birthday this week. It's Callie's birthday. Tim, how old is she going to be? Oh, my goodness. Oh, wow. I think we all remember when she was born. So when she is back in children's ministry today, when you see her after service, make sure to say happy birthday to her. I don't have any other birthdays or anniversaries unless I miss somebody. Nope. So let's pray for our military and our police. Please pray this with me. I am not moving, Keegan. There. Father, we exercise our covenant authority over the enemy. We demand the killing, destruction, and confusion over American soldiers, our police, and all who stand with them to stop now. We charge angels to protect and guide them, and we speak the blood of Jesus and the protection of the 91st Psalm over them now. Jesus is Lord over Iraq, Afghanistan, United States of America, and all the earth. Amen. All right, and today we are having God's Army, their advancement ceremony.
And I was thinking our program was similar to that because they, I'm sure, have been prepared for that time that was coming. Those leaders that were selected were the cream of the crop. They were prepared for that time, and these children are prepared for this time. Those people looked opulent that I saw on the television. I was impressed with what I saw on every part of it, and I'm impressed with God's Army class. And they look awesome today as well. I'm very proud of every one of them. I'm going to call each and every one of them up. I need Earl. Is Earl? Oh, he's back there. He's our drill sergeant. And as I call them up, I'm going to ask them a few questions, and they're going to answer. All right, Evelyn. Evelyn, have you met all the requirements for advancement with 75% accuracy and skills and attitude or greater? Have you been on time, in your place, ready to execute your assignment given? Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and advancement in God's Army class? Evelyn, the character trait I have chosen for you is consistency. You are here on time week after week. You are ready with your ideas, your moves for new songs, and your ideas for the puppet ministry. You remember every detail of our classroom regimen, and this consistency has made my job much easier, even in remembering everyone's title. Thank you and congratulations on your advancement, Sergeant First Class Evelyn. Oh, you get to stay up here, Evelyn. All right, Lydia. Lydia, Have you met all requirements for advancement with 75% accuracy and skills in attitude or greater?
Yes, ma'am.
Have you been on time, in your place, ready to execute your assignment given?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and advancement in God's Army class?
Yes, ma'am.
Lydia, the character quality that I have chosen for you is discernment and faithfulness. You are always asking me what you can do to help me and what needs to be done in our classroom. You are always the last one to leave every single class, and you have a discerning spirit and have helped with the direction of our class in which way we should go. I'm so very proud to have you in our class, and it is a pleasure to have your leadership. Page. Page. Have you met all the requirements for advancement with 75% accuracy in skills and attitude or greater?
Yes.
Have you been on time, in your place, and ready to execute your assignment given? Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and advancement in God's Army class? Paige, your character trait that I have chosen for you is consistency. You are the first one to arrive week after week with a smile on your face. You are in your spot. You redirect children as they arrive, and you do this well. You are a great example to the children in this one area. Every week, consistently, you have remembered your tithe. In the last 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 years, I cannot remember once or twice when you haven't had it. That is great, and I love it. Thank you. Let's see. Stay up here for Zoe. Zoe, would you come up here, please? Paige helps Zoe a little bit by shadowing her. Come on over here, Zoe. Good job. Zoe, have you met all of our requirements for advancement with 75% accuracy in skills and attitude or greater? Good job. Have you been on time, in your place, ready to execute your assignment given? Good. Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and ready for advancement in God's Army class, Zoe? Good job. Zoe loves our classroom, comes in every week, and she's ready to participate. Whether it's singing, dancing, crafts, or games, she always participates in everything and enjoys every activity. The character quality I have chosen for Zoe is sweetness. She gives me a fist bump every time she arrives in class. Congratulations, Zoe. Staff Sergeant Zoe, here's your paper. Good job. Marita. Marita. Have you met all of our requirements for advancement with 75% accuracy in skills and attitude or greater?
Yes.
Have you been on time, in your place, ready to execute your assignments that's been given?
Yes.
Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and advancement in God's Army class?
Yes.
Marita, the character quality that I have chosen for you is enthusiasm. You have done the most changing this year in your personality and your quality of work in 2016. Week after week, doing your job with a great attitude and being a great example in dance, in your confessions, and your game leadership. This enthusiasm is greatly appreciated by me and the others in our classroom, and I'm proud to advance you. Jaden. Jaden, have you been consistent week after week in following the rules 75% of the time? Have you been a good example to the others in what you say and what you do? Are you looking for ways to bless other cadets and ways to help them in class? Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and advancement in God's Army class? Jaden, the character quality that I have chosen for you is encourager. You always say, good job, after anyone has done anything in our classroom and congratulate them on their success. You have done this for at least the last year or two. You're dancing and participating in every single time you come forward. You're one of the first people up in front to volunteer, to dance, and you're a great example to the others in attitude and what you do. You do not lack enthusiasm in our classroom. I'm so proud to advance you, Private Jaden. Congratulations. All right, Samuel. Okay, Samuel, have you been consistent week after week in following our rules 75% or more of the time? Have you been a good example to others in what you say and what you do? Are you looking for ways, Samuel, to bless and to help other cadets in the classroom? Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and advancement in God's Army class? Samuel, the character quality that I have chosen for you is initiative. You come early, and you always come with a great attitude, and you ask me, how can I help you, Major Christine? You have done this consistently for over a year. You consistently have been the one that's called me Major Christine, or yes, ma'am, from the very beginning. This is setting a great example to the others in the classroom. Whenever I need something done, especially with one of the little ones, you are always the first one to volunteer, Samuel. You volunteer to help Joel to take him to the bathroom to wash his hands and all the other little ones. This helps me out greatly in the classroom. And I'm proud to advance you, Samuel. Private. Congratulations. Hannah. Hannah, have you been a good example to the others in what you say and what you do? Are you looking for ways to bless other cadets in our classroom and help them? Have you been consistent week after week in following the rules 75% or more of the time? Are you ready for increase from your Heavenly Father and advancement in God's Army class? Hannah, the character quality that I have chosen for you is joyfulness. Whether it is dancing, confessing, playing games, or listening to a sermon, you always participate with a smile on your face with a great attitude full of joy. You love to bless others and help others with hugs and kisses. You are very affectionate. Hannah, you are very selfless, and it's a pleasure to have you in my class. Private Hannah, congratulations. Our other two are going to be advancing soon, and if I had to come up with a character quality for that, it would be very simple. These two are the most loving in our classroom. Hugs, kisses, back rubs, and private I love yous continuously. Those two. I got a secret. I want to tell you something. Yes, I love you, Major Christine, all the time, every week. Those two, by far, are my most loving two. These are our future generation, and I think we can all be proud of them. Let's give them a hand clap.
I am so proud of these kids. I get to see them during the week, and I am blessed beyond blessings. Just take a look at that. Now, I don't want to break this again. See, that's why we had to get a lighter podium so I could move it about. Just look at this. Come on over this way, kids. This is the future of America. Would you play the song, "I'm Proud to Be an American"? God is good. I want you to stand when we're singing this. And these kids are going to sing along right up here. You're just going to hold them, okay?
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. There ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
That note, what we're going to do is we're going to take communion. Children, I'm going to ask you to just wait down with Major Christina. Thank you, and we won't go out. We'll take communion together, okay? And then have your tithe and your offering ready. First, we're going to take the tithe, and then our second time we'll go around. We're going to take an offering, but it's going to be for our Civil Air Patrol. And we'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. But let's do this here. Let's take communion, because we can say we bless the United States of America. Why would that be? Because this country was founded on "In God We Trust." And I love it, because on our police cars, what does it say? What are they putting on the police cars now? "In God We Trust." Is that what it says on your money? We still stand strong. And guess what? God is going to make America great again.
Amen.
God is good.
All the time.
Amen. When we take this communion, this is saying we have a covenant with God. And in this bread, this is the bread of life. That's what it is reminding us of. If there's anything you have need of, you take that now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Because this is the year your struggles are finished. Amen. Your struggles are finished. Your struggles with health, your struggles with finances, your struggles with children, your struggles are finished.
Amen.
God said there's an ease. And Minister Keisha even brought it up in Mark 11. And that is your yoke and your burdens are light. Got it? Well, God said read that. Give me my Bible there, please. Okay. God is good.
All the time.
Absolutely. I made a special little note here. It says, in Matthew 11, 28 through 30, this is the New King James, and I don't have the New King James in here. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That is for us for this day forward. Take my yoke upon you and lean on me, lean on God. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. What is your souls? For your mind. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light, says the Lord of hosts. So now we know from this day forward, your life will be with ease. Because if two or more set themselves in agreement, in Matthew 18, 19, it says, again I say to you, if two of you agree on anything here on earth, my Father in heaven will accept it. If two or more agree together, where two or three have come together in my name, I am there among them. Listen, if I have... Oh, pretend this is candy, Sam. But if I am here, and I had a piece of candy for everyone, pretend, okay? But if I'm not here, and I say, Pastor Jan has candy for you, well, I'm not here to give it to you. But if I'm here, and I say, I'm going to give you candy, and I have the candy, I'm going to give it out to you. Well, God is here when two or more come together, and they will have whatever they agree upon. But you've got to come into agreement. We've got to come in agreement with God and the way God wants it done. Do you agree?
Amen.
So now we have an agreement. Whatever you have need of, here is the bread of life that has already supplied it. In the name of Jesus, let's break it and eat and receive it. Receive whatever you have need of. And then we will take. Thank you, Father. This is communion. We'll have some parents help out here. Good. We've got Evelyn helping. Thank you. Good. She'll get it open. We're looking at our future Americans. Now, Father God, this here simulates the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus is what set us free from sin. The blood of Jesus is what has covered us, what heals us, what opens every door that no man can shut. And I thank you for that, Father. In the name of Jesus, let's drink. And that being said, first we're going to take our tithe. And then we will do offering. So through that, do you have a song for us, Debbie? All right, let's do our song. You can take yours back there. I missed a part. I want these little ones to come up right here. Where did my oil go? Max, come on up here. Yeah, line them right up here. Ushers, where are my ushers? Line them up. I want you to put this on your hand. You're going to lay hands on these children as I am. And we're going to decree and declare the blessings of the Lord Jesus Christ. When you touch these kids, you're decreeing and declaring a thing over these children. Because they have moved up a level. They have shown themselves strong. Do they have challenges in their life? Yes. But we're the ones that can help them. Do you believe it? So first I will lay hands and then Max, you will hands. I agree. In the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I agree, in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I agree, in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I agree, in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I agree, in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I agree, in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I agree, in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. Come on down. Come on down. Miss Christina, we're going to lay hands on you too. I agree in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I agree in the name of Jesus, you are blessed. I want Christina right here, and I'm going to pray over her. We're going to lay hands on her. Father, we thank you. We thank you in the name of Jesus. I'm going to lay my hands here. You're going to put it on her head. Father God, we agree now in the name of Jesus that every blessing comes upon her. There is wealth in her house. There is health in her house. There is peace in her house. There is ever-increasing faithfulness in her house. And I thank you, Father God, for a servant of the Lord. And I call you blessed in Jesus' name. Receive it. Thank you, Father God, for the blessings. Just let him absorb every fiber of your being. In Jesus' name. Do you agree?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, you are released. Children, you are released, and I thank you so much. And as they're standing down here, let's praise God right now, and we're going to take our tithe. And this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be. This is the most exciting time of the service. And the reason I say it is the most exciting time is because you get to do your part so that he will give you overflow in every area of your life. Do you receive that? Let's do it, Minister Debbie.
Oh, the wealth of the wicked is laid out for the just. It gives God pleasure to see you prosperous. Blessed is the man who in that promise trusts. Oh, the wealth of the wicked is laid out for the just. When you delight in the word of God and meditate in the truth, you're like a tree planted by the rivers bearing lots of fruit. You're blessed in the city and blessed in the field because of your diligent hand. God says, look as far as you see, it shows the promised land. Oh, the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. It gives God pleasure to see you prosperous. Blessed is the man who in that promise trusts. Oh, the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. Oh, the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just.
It gives God pleasure to see you prosperous. Blessed is the man who in that promise trusts. All the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. All the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. Yes, the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just.
That's us.
You said that when we give, you're going to give unto us, but you're going to multiply it.
Amen.
Not one, two, three, but you're going to multiply it 100-fold return. We thank you, Father, for that in the name of Jesus. Now, thank you. Now what we're going to do, offering. We're going to give an offering, and we're going to ask Mark to come up here, please. We were so blessed, and you probably even saw that when I went out on Facebook. Come on up here, please. We were very blessed, Pastor Kenny and I, and we went out to Buffalo Wild Wings, and that was a fundraiser for the Civil Air Patrol. Got to get that all out. I got to sit in their little plane. I got to sit in that little plane. I was ready to drive it. No, fly it.
You look good in there, too.
See, did you hear that? Did y'all hear that? Kenny, did you hear that?
I'm
going to have to take lessons, aren't I? No, when you've got a pilot, why do you have to take a lesson? Let him. But people can.
Just need a plane.
Just need a plane. We're going to get that too, aren't we? But I want you to tell us, because, and then we'll release the fellows, I want you to share with us what this offering, and this isn't just this Sunday, but you can do it anytime you want, but you would make the check out or whatever to Civil Air Patrol, not to the church. And that will go, everything that is given now in the offering will go to the Civil Air Patrol, okay? And the church is as well going to bless, all right? So would you please share with us, where would this money go and what would it help with?
Just a little background. Civil Air Patrol has been around since December 1st, 1941, and it was started as a bunch of volunteers that wanted to serve their country and protect against everything that was going on in the world back then, just before World War II, the uprising of Hitler. So today, Civil Air Patrol still serves the community. It's still a charitable organization. It's still run by volunteers. We receive a little bit of funding from the government through the Air Force, but most of our funding comes through generous donations. And we have a youth program for young people 12 to 21, and we teach them character. We teach them search and rescue skills. We teach them leadership. And we also have search and rescue or emergency services, and we provide support to our government agencies. And with government funding becoming shorter and shorter, we take on more and more responsibilities as civilians in this role. So your money would stay here locally. If it was given to Civil Air Patrol, then it would support the local youth program and the community services efforts of the 75 volunteers here in the Fox Valley to provide resources for the community. So if someone's lost, we search for... we've had search missions we've been on for Alzheimer's patients, for lost vehicles, for missing hunters, missing hikers. We work with the local law enforcement, but we are a group of volunteers, so that's where the funds would go.
Amen. Thank you so much, Mark.
Matthew's a cadet. He's
come
been,
on up, Matthew,
Matthew's
please.
Been a Civil Air Patrol cadet, so
he's almost as tall as me. Listen, inside, I'm taller than he is.
So my little boy here has been a cadet since 13. I'm proud of him. Our daughter Lauren's a member of Civil Air Patrol, too.
I didn't know that.
So it's become a family tradition. I joined when I was 13 years old, so it's been something we've been involved in as a family for many years. But Matthew joined at 13, and almost 13, and he wanted to get involved in the Air Cadet program. And when he joined, he was quiet and a little shy and bashful, and just like now, no,
like me,
like
me,
just like all of the other young people that join. We watched them grow up and take on leadership skills and responsibility, and develop confidence. And he's traveled to nationwide type training during the summers, and just been able to do a lot of things. Matthew is actually our most experienced communications specialist in the squadron as a teenager. Yeah, he actually knows more than any of our adult members at the moment, and he's a qualified ground search and rescue member. So if there was a need, if one of you were lost and we sent our plane up to go look for you, Matthew would be on the ground in our vehicle conducting the ground part of the search. So I'd be in the plane and Matthew would be on the ground. So it's a great program, because not only is he developing these leadership skills, leading the other youth, but and not just Matthew, but all of our young people. But they're also learning real world abilities they'll be able to take into the workforce and in their adult life.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Thanks for doing that, Matthew.
Lauren, would you just turn around and wave because you're a member of the Civil Air Command?
That's Second Lieutenant Nemi over there.
Okay, good. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. That is good. So let's take up our offering, please. I didn't want to forget that. Yep, there it goes. Okay, let's do that at this time. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father God. And if some people have forgotten, next Sunday, we will do the same thing, okay? Or Wednesday night. But make the check out to the Civil Air Patrol. They're a 501c3, so you can also take that as a write-off on your taxes if you'd like. God is good. You know, anything to serve our young people in the valley, I think, is wonderful. Okay? I think it is awesome. I know that also. Yeah, I have to brag on that. Max, come on up here. Where did we put that microphone? You're just on the ball, aren't you? Come on up, Maxwell. Max has been, he's training up to minister, to become a pastor. So I've been working very hard. We've been working very hard together, and along with Kim, as she is the leader, and he is working under her. They have been going out and doing things. Tell us a couple of things you've been doing out there. He didn't know I was going to do this.
One of the things we've been doing is going out and shoveling and helping the community.
This is what Debbie makes you do.
Okay.
Yeah, there.
So one of the things we've been doing is going out over in the Kimberley area and just on a snowstorm and shoveling and occasionally salt our driveways, because I used to live over in that area, and my mother was a single mom, so sometimes we, you know, our neighbor had a snowblower, we all had a shovel, so I was like, you know, why can't they just come over and help me? But, you know, so I kind of wanted to, you know, just having that memory, go out and do that for people, you know, that don't have a snowblower, that are elderly, or just to show an act of love in the community through our youth group, you know, because everybody can go door to door and preach the word of God, but actions speak louder than words. And
mm-hmm.
I actually, you know, actually had a younger guy, he's probably like 28, come up to me and said that, you know, actions do speak louder words, and was thankful for what we're doing. And you know, that's, and then we've been helping clean the multi-purpose room, and just stuff like that.
Yes, amen. Thank you. We appreciate this all. The anointing oil is still on here. I mean, it is. Smells good, doesn't it, Max? You turn it off, okay? Men, you are released for the men's study, but otherwise, the other ones, we're going to stand here. And what we're going to do is we're going to go to the scriptures. We're going to go to Ephesians. We're going to ask that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, you're the Father of glory, that you would give unto each one of us your spirit of wisdom, your revelation for the knowledge of you, for the eyes of our understanding to be opened, to be enlightened, so that we would know what is the hope of your calling, what is the riches of your glory, what is our inheritance as your saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of your power toward us who believe, according to the working of your mighty power, which you wrought in Christ when you raised him from the dead and you seated him at your own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Daddy, you have put all things under Jesus' feet. You have given Jesus to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body. Now we are the body. You are the head, God. And we are the fullness of you that filleth all in all. That's what you said, Daddy, and I totally agree with you. In Jesus' name, do you agree? We have an agreement. Now, what you can do is you can receive the word to the fullness, or you don't have to. That's up to you. But it's just like if somebody gives you, you're really thirsty, and somebody gives you a glass of water. If Matthew was really thirsty and I gave him a glass of water, would he pour it out? What would you do with it, Matthew? You would drink it. You see, God gives us his flowing, living water. When it talks about water, in the Bible, it talks about God's living water, which is the Word of God. And when He has it come flowing out, that's the fruit of my lips that are going forth. And you can take that living water and you can drink it in, and it can prosper you in every area of your life. It's up to the individual to do it. Amen. You may be seated. Well, I dressed for the Packer game. Hey, guys, look at here. I'm dressed for the Packer game. Don't you think that'll work? Dee Dee's all dressed up. Carrie's dressed up. I tell you, we're looking good. This is just a little warm, though. Just a little warm. I didn't think it'd be this warm in here. But this is what we're going to do. We're not going to spend a whole lot of time. And the reason is because we don't have a whole lot of time, do we? Well, we've really got all day. We really do. God, is God shifting things in this earth? Do you like it sometimes when it shifts? But if it doesn't go the way you want it, then you don't like it, do you? No, but now we just, you know what? God has just shifted this whole thing over. Now we have a born-again, spirit-filled president in office. Amen. Amen. You know what? We're going to pray for all the demonstrators. And the reason we're going to do that, because they have no idea what they're doing. Because we know that when Moses came down from Mount Sinai, he saw all the parting going on. He saw all that was going on, and it was so wrong. And some of the people still had Egypt in their heart. Why? Because they built a golden calf. That was the Egyptians' God. That wasn't the Israelites' God. Moses said, now God said through Moses, tell him, come and stand with me, whoever stands with God. A lot of the people came and stood with him, but there's still a lot that didn't stand with him. So God said, take the sword and go back and forth and wipe them off the face of the earth. What he was doing is he was wiping evil off. There was another time in the scripture when Moses gave people the opportunity. And that opportunity was stand with me or don't stand with me. It's two opportunities like that Moses gave. But this time, God said, it's not going to be the same way. I'm going to open up the earth and I'm going to swallow it up. What is in the center of this earth? Hell is in the center of this earth. Would you ever believe that? Yeah, it's in the center of the earth. But we're even over hell. That's what Jesus gave us. He gave us that position. We are the daughters and the sons of God. And God has ordained us as such a time for this, to stand up and be counted. Now, we have been praying. We've been praying for our president. We've been praying for other leaders, have we not? And God said, if you will humble yourself, seek my face, pray, I will turn, I'll put it my way, I will turn these things around. So when you hear people bad-mouthing Donald Trump or Pence or any one of them, just give them to the Lord. And, you know, this is what I do. I hear that, and Lord, I give them to you. I thank you that their eyes and ears are open to you in the name of Jesus. You know, it saddens my heart when I heard this on TV yesterday. It was on Waters World. And he went out there, and he was talking to these demonstrators on the day of the inauguration. Do you know that day? And was it only five blocks away that there were protesters that were breaking windows, Starbucks windows and the bank's windows and stuff? You saw that. And he went down there and he said, are you guys getting paid by Soros to do that? Raise your hands. 15 raised their hands. It was the 15 with the mask and the crowbars and things to bring destruction. Do you think the earth is going to open up? Do you think things are not going to be good for him? But I pray for his salvation. I don't want to see anybody lost. God does not want to see anybody lost. But when you look at the destruction, when you see people that are coming up against Pence, they're coming up against President Donald Trump, you know what's going to happen? See, I love Obama. I do. But I hate the evil. All right? I love Soros, but I hate the evil. That's the only thing God said we could hate was evil. So now I want turnaround. But now, isn't that something? This is a, this is something that it says, the enemy fights hardest when he knows God has something great in store for America. I add in America. See, the devil knows there's something great for America, and that is why he's fighting so bad. Yesterday, they had the women's march out there, and they interviewed some of the... Did you see that? They were interviewing some of the women. They had no idea why they were even out there. They had no idea. Some of them were, well, we're just here. We just thought we should be a part of it. Oh, well, we're on our way to hell. Do you want to be a part of that too? No. See, people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. We do not want to be destroyed for lack of knowledge. That's why we watch and we listen and we pray. But the thing of it is, when we join God, there's going to be good things that happen. But when we join the enemy, good things are not going to happen. So we can choose this day, like it says in Deuteronomy 30:19, we can choose this day whom we're going to serve. I choose to serve God. Sometimes it's really hard to put my flesh under and to choose to serve him. It really is, because there are things that your flesh, like Paul said, I put my flesh under, I do, but I don't, but I really want to do this wrong, but I don't, because of the cause of Christ. Isn't that what, do we fight sometimes? Don't you think sometimes when you want to do something, don't you in a way wish somebody would just take you and lock you in a room so you wouldn't do that wrong or that harm? Like chocolate girls, take the chocolate away, take it out of America. No, that's not going to happen. But now the devil knows, don't forget, the enemy fights the hardest when he knows we have the best. So now we plead the blood of Jesus, and I want your agreement on this, over Donald Trump, over his cabinet, over this United States of America, all over the world. I plead the blood, because the blood never loses its power. The blood protects in the name of Jesus. Then we have an agreement. So now what I'm going to share with you a little bit, the power of agreement. Would you bring that up, Keegan, please? This is a power of agreement, and we're not going to give you a whole bunch. But we'll be speaking on this for a while, because this is so important. When I learned about this, this was all before we were in this building. I learned about the power of agreement. And I thought, wait a minute. Kenny wasn't even born again at that time. Okay? And I didn't really understand it. But then later on, all right, when we were in ministry and so on like that, I started understanding the power of agreement. But just look at this scripture, what it says here. It says in Matthew 18:19-20, he says, is it up, Keegan? He says, again I say to you, I'll just give you a minute there. He says, again, would you read this with me? Please, it'll get into you, Father. Let's read. Again I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, oops, I've got the... Okay, I'll go back to that one. I've got that one down here, and I was going to use the other one first, but this is good. Well, let me finish the one I'm on, then we'll read this. So keep it up, Keegan. He says, again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that you ask, what does ask mean? Oh, I'm giving away something I was going to give a challenge to Max for. What does ask mean?
Amen.
What does it mean? God says, put a demand on me.
Yes.
God is telling you to put a demand on him. Are you kidding me? He's saying, what my son went and died on the cross for, now you demand. The devil gets his hands off it, and it comes to you. You put a demand on God, the word that is written. You put a demand and cause a bunch of trouble for the devil. So he's saying ask. Ask means demand. It will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of him. Just like I said with the kids before, I have candy for you, but I'm in the midst of them, and I have the candy, and I can give it. If I'm not there with them, how can I give it to them? But he's in the midst. If two or more come together, he's in the midst of it. Oh, how wonderful. Now, let's read this one together. I can guarantee again that if two of you agree on the earth, my Father in heaven will accept it. Where two or three have come together in my name, I am there among them. That is a pretty, pretty strong scripture, would you say? That's why I tell people, when you're going someplace, you're going to a battle, I don't care where you're going, two, go two by two. Jesus sent out the disciples two by two. Why? Because they connected. There's a spiritual connection there for that whole situation, no matter where it is. We understand that, don't we? So now, sometimes, too many times, we get discouraged in this life. Do you ever get discouraged? I get discouraged sometimes, but you know what I have to do? I have to put on my righteousness. What is my righteousness? When I speak the word. Putting on the breastplate of righteousness means speaking the word. So when I speak the word, that word is the sword of the Spirit, and I wield that at the devil. When I take and wield something at somebody, I'm going to do it. I'm really going to do it. When I wheel, I told him, I said, I'm really going to do it. He didn't. You could have wheeled it back. I would have caught it. I said, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it, Matthew. I'm really going to do it. Okay, I'm going to do it, Matthew, and I did it. Listen, I was good at baseball. So when God said he's going to do something, he's going to do it. You got to take it through. I really thought he was going to catch it. I really did it first time. But that was a great example. Thank you. And that was a great example. So we wield the word of God at the devil, and what has to happen? The devil has to back off. When you say in Jesus' name, or you say, I plead the blood of Jesus, do you know what he does? He hikes and he runs, because that's the fruit. That's the fruit of our lips coming out, and it's destroying the enemy from coming up against us in any way. In Matthew 11:12, this is so delicious. And it says, if you look up there, and from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Who are the violent? Is there, now, we know that when we look up in the air, we see the first heaven. And then there's a second heaven, right? Where does God dwell? The third heaven. That's where you're seated, in the third heaven. But where is the devil? He's the power of the air. And that's why he's wheeling at us discouragement. That's why he's lying to you and say, you're never going to get out of that situation. You know, it's always going to be the same. You know, every time you turn around, you think you're getting ahead. Do you know, now the car broke down, and now... the water froze up in the house. Oh, my goodness. The kids are on a rampage, and two of them ran away last week. I say, let them go. I'm from the old school, Mary. I always say, you're coming back. What for? Please leave again. I'm just all love. I'm just all love. Don't forget that. I'm just love. Listen, my kids are doing good. I got three kids that are doing very good. No problem. But I let the door open. But when you come back, put another log on the fire, because it's going to be the same rules, the same situations as when you left. But you're going to change them, right? By your changing your mind. So now, getting back to this, God said we don't have to be discouraged about anything. We do not have to be discouraged about anything. The devil, when he steals, and you find out who the thief is. Okay, I'm going to use you again. Come here, Matthew. Now, this is very important to me. Go behind my back and take it from me. I didn't see him take it. Now go sit down. I didn't see him take it. Pretend I didn't see him take it. Wait a minute, Lord. You just showed me the thief. Because I see my book. I see my book. I found the thief. Come on, Satan. He's not really saying... I need my recompense. He would have to give me sevenfold. Seven times. Thank you, Matthew. When you find a thief, you demand that he gives it back. You know what? He even had to come to me. He came and he stole it. He came and he gave it back. He's got to. Because who is in control on this earth? It says in Genesis 1:26, you are. Genesis 20, because God said in Genesis 1:26, he said, I give you the dominion. I give you the authority on this earth to tread upon scorpions and snakes and every, I give you the authority to ask and you shall receive. I give it to you. So once you have it, God says, now put on that breastplate of righteousness and take that sword of the Spirit and wheel it after the devil and make him come to you. Things are going to be coming to you now. You're not going to have to seek after things. Things are going to come to you. Things are going to come to you. Things are going to come to you. You know what? You look at this. You keep on doing it. You know, did you ever keep on doing the same thing over and over and you know it's right what you're doing? Did you ever do that? You know it's right what you're doing? And then suddenly, the heavens open up and you say, wow, I can't believe it. Well, honey, you've been doing it right all the time, according to the Word of God. Because sometimes we get discouraged when we're working the Word of God, when we're making our confessions, and our confessions mean, Father God, I decree and declare that every day I'm blessed. I decree and declare that I have favor everywhere that I go. I decree and declare, money, you come to me. I have need of you to further the gospel of Jesus Christ. Health, you come to me. You're making your confessions, and it just doesn't look like it's going to happen, and you start getting discouraged. That's when you have to pick up and cause more violence in the heavenlies. And how do you do that, Lynn? You do it with the Word of God. Take the Word of God. Get another scripture that gets you stirred up and wheel that thing at the devil. Knock him right to the other side of kingdom come, so to speak. Put him against the wall that he sticks there. How about putting him outside? Just think, he has a right to be in here. He has a right to be anywhere he has until the very end. And then he'll be bound and he'll be thrown into the lake of fire, never to come up again and harm us. God is good. Oh, I like that. So he's telling us there will be seasons in our life. There will be seasons that we go through. But those seasons in our life will make us stronger. Okay, yesterday I was on the treadmill. I know it was a sin, but I was on there and I'm walking, you know. And, oh, I don't like to do that. I would just like to lay or just, you know, did you ever see this ad with this little boy? I don't know what he's just sitting on his little laptop or something like that. And he's doing something. He's a little bit heavier, you know, in stature. And the grandma's working in the other room and he dials up grandma and she answers the phone. Hey, grandma, can you bring me another grape soda? Did you see that? You didn't see that? Oh, that I laugh every time I see it. I thought I'd go yank that little puppy off the sofa and I would help his attitude. But that's what we like to do sometimes. There's things I don't want to do, but I do it because I know it's good. We understand that, don't we? So we all go through struggles. But when you look at this here, you can go through that struggle. And you're causing violence in the heavenly against the enemy when you speak the word of God. Because remember, what does it say in Jeremiah 1:12 and Isaiah 55:11? When you speak the word, it's going to go up and it's going to come down. Just like the rain. What is the rain? The rain comes down, the rain goes up. It fills up the clouds, it comes down. There's a cycle, isn't there? With the word, God says, he will always, always, always fulfill the promises that you spoke. Because it goes to him, comes back. How fast does it get to him? There is no time in heaven is as close as your own eyeballs, as your own body. Fast it gets to him. So he's telling us in Matthew 11:28-30, and he's saying, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. Think of that. When things are hitting the fan and nothing seems to go right, he says, come to me and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. That's for your mind. And when your mind is at rest, your body will be at rest. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So God says that we can rest and operate in ease and let the cares and the struggles and all of that behind. And God has said to me, and you know, you look at like 2017, Kenneth Copeland prophesied. And I've read it, so I'm not going to go through it here, but look it up on his website, or if you want it, we'll send it to you via email or something. We're not going to have to struggle anymore. We have stood and we have prayed. It's kind of like this. You bake a cake, you mix the batter all up. Girls, you know what I'm talking about. Guys, you can catch this too. You mix the batter up, you put it in the pan, and then where do you put it? Do you have to sit in there and blow and heat it up and everything? What makes it bake? When you take the word of God and you speak it, it's in the oven and God will bake it and it'll come out just tremendous. Even if you put salt in instead of sugar the way you should have, he'll make it come out right. That's the way he does it because he's good all the time. I did that already. I put a little salt too much in a cake and it just didn't do it so well. So when you're going through constant struggles and pressures and things like that, just say, Father, I give this to you. I give it to you. I thank you. 1 Peter 5:6, he says, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. God, what is he saying with that? He's saying submit. Humble means to submit in that verse. So submit to my word and do what is right. Right? And then you have this situation, you cast that care on him because he cares for you. You know what? Have you ever tried to be God to somebody else? I tried that one time, long time ago. And it got me in trouble. I kept on trying to help a person, a family member, and help him, and give him money and do all that. It caught up to me where she turned on me. You see, in their hearts, even though she was having the problem, okay, it's in her heart that I was not supposed to be doing that. But praise God, the time came when she got an inheritance from my parents as well. And the Lord said, you call her and tell her you want payback. Because I had borrowed it. You know how you say, I'm going to borrow, but you never take it back? Do you know that day things turned around with her and we had a friendship again? Otherwise, they will hate you. And there was a hate going on from her direction. And it hurt my heart. But it was my fault. But I had to turn it around. And I did, and praise God. So God said, if two or more come into agreement, what is going to happen again in Matthew 11:12, New King James? And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. He tells us that there is a season, I'm going to say it again, that there's seasons of our life that you're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. You're going to have to fight the good fight of faith. I have to say this, when I was having kidney trouble, okay, this went for about a year and a half, and I think my kids still remember this. And I would end up in the emergency room, I think it was like every other month, if not every month, with excruciating pain and throwing up. And finally, the last time I went in, this one doctor, I can still see his face. He said, Mrs. Fredrickson, I think you're just coming in here to get drugs. I'm laying on this steel table. You know how to put those little pads on there? That ain't much. They're probably better now. I started crying. He left the room. The nurse is crying. She's crying too. There's no way I could manufacture throwing up and having that kind of pain. And I just got before God and I said, I can't take this anymore. He said, I can't come back anymore because I'm just after drugs. Found a doctor. And they checked everything out. They said, we can't find anything. Well, this one doctor who was a Jew couldn't rest. He said, I think we see a shadow behind your stomach. What is that? I don't know, but I think we got to check it out. It's in your kidney. So So he said, this is what we're going to do. We're going to have to put you to sleep because we have to go into that kidney. We can't open it up because if it is cancer, we're in trouble. You're in trouble. But I'm going to go in there, and then we're going to have to test it immediately. And if it is cancer, we're going to draw out and walk away. If it is cancer, we're going to draw out and walk away, and that's it. You're going to have to live with that thing and blah, blah, blah. Or if it isn't, we're going to do surgery and see whatever that is and take it out of there. Well, they did that. Well, my mother heard this as well. So here, my mom and Kenny are sitting out there in the waiting room. And as I'm going in there the night before, I had two godly people agree together with me in prayer. I didn't worry about anything. I said, if I die, I go to heaven. If I live, I stay here. So mom was like, oh, Kenny, she called him Smiley at the time. That's Kenny's nickname from high school. Smiley, it's got to take a long time because, so she, you know what? Do you see what mamas do? We cry. Well, anyway, they went in there and they took the biopsy and it wasn't cancer. It was a cyst. And it had been pinched down in the size of a barbell, looking like a barbell with a, like he said, a grapefruit on each end of it in that little kidney that was causing this pain. And every time it would grow, it would cause this excruciating pain. I just give glory to God that they found it because I wanted to go back to that hospital and said to that doctor, not even remember his name, I wanted to say, hey, remember you said, but God said, you don't have to do that. I'll take care of it. So anyway, they came out and told the doctor. They came out and said, you know, we're done. And my mom just started crying. Kenny's like, she's crying. Oh, no. Oh, no. Why? Because it was too soon for me to come out, according to her. But I was thinner than now, so they didn't have to go through layers of fat. This is what they told me. This is what the doctor came in and told me as he's standing at the end of the bed. He said, we didn't have to go through layers of fat. He said, we were just able to go in there. And he said, the thing was not even connected. There was nothing it was connected to. Who cut that connection? Who cut that feeding tube to that? God Almighty cut it. Is he good? All the time. My God is good, but the devil was trying to wipe me out and he couldn't do it, could he? It was so wonderful because as my mom got the story, she's laughing and crying and then she's like, why didn't that doctor tell me right away when he came out? She's okay, she's okay. Why did he come and just stand there and oh, you know what I mean? But when we go through struggles like that, what happens? The devil comes and he pelts our mind, doesn't he? He just pelts. Well, I was having such a good time in the hospital. I tried to get out of bed and I had my friend come and try to wash my hair, you know, to get me home sooner. Ooh, that wasn't good. But then my brother Vernon come up. You know, I talk about my brother Vernon. He's a piece of work. My brother Vernon is a piece of work. And he came up there and he started joking with me and they just put those staples, you know. And see, the thing is about that long, the where they cut you. Well, on your back, you know, in the kidney. And he's joking. He's joking with me. And I'm laughing and the nurse comes in there and she's not liking this and I'm supposed to be quiet. Well, she checks the bandage and it is bloody because it's bleeding. Oh, I said it'll be okay. Vernon, get out of here. We still remember that. So what Satan meant for evil, God used for good. There isn't anything impossible for my God. Nothing is impossible for your God. But God says you got to ask. You got to put a demand, and that will cause violence in the heavenlies. So whenever you're having struggles, what do? Father, I give this to you. If I'm doing something wrong, show me so I can turn it around because I don't know what I'm doing. But then get in agreement. You know what's wonderful is God has put marriage. That's the first covenant on this earth is marriage. And he had it so a man and a woman, okay, would come together and they would agree on something. But many times, maybe we can't get agreement with our spouse. But then get another born-again, spirit-filled believer, one that's higher in the beliefs, and their faith is way out there. And you have them set themselves in agreement with you, and you will see things turn around. There's some things Pastor Kenny and I don't agree on, so we just leave it alone. Now it's a whole lot better. It's a whole lot better. It used to be, well, I can't. I said, don't say one more word me and the Holy Spirit will agree. I remember a situation, Dee Dee and I agreed that one of the guys that worked for us, he would leave or we'd let him go. We got an agreement, what, it was a year later, almost a year later? Probably. The guy quit, went and got a good job. We didn't want him out there just floating around. When two or more come together, and whatever they agree on, they will have it. And that's why having this in a marriage is perfect. If you don't have it, find somebody else. If you don't have anybody, God said, I got the Holy Spirit, I sent him. Get an agreement with him and cause some violence in the heavenlies. Don't you like to cause a little violence for the devil sometimes? Don't you like to do that? Matthew 11, 28 and 30, he said, come to me, all of you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So whenever you have the heaviness of the devil that's coming up against you, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know, looking at this here, and I'm going to pass one up there, and I'll maybe catch up on it next week. But I wanted to go to Acts 3. And on there, on Acts 3, 1, it says, now Peter and John went up into the temple and at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms, and alms are people who couldn't walk, people who couldn't take care of themselves in that day. They didn't have welfare, not like now. We shouldn't have welfare. We really shouldn't. It's not of God. Because people can go on welfare and they don't have to trust God because now the world has become their God. We understand that, don't we? No. So what you work with your hands, you eat from your own hands, not from another. So alms mean that man at the gate of Beautiful was crippled. And that's how they were supported then. But it was he was sitting at the gate of the temple. And the people were putting money into his hands to ask for alms of them that entered into the temple, who seeing Peter and John again to go into the temple, asked an alms. And people fastened, and Peter, I like this, and Peter fastened his eyes upon him with John, two in agreement. Two in agreement. Said, look on us. Can you imagine that? Could you imagine that? Can you only imagine that? You got to get this here. Here's Peter and John. Here's Peter and John. And pretend he's crippled. And they fastened their eyes on him. He's asking for alms because that's the way they did it. They fastened their eyes on him and they said, took by the hand, rise up. And took him right off there. And he walked and leaped. Wow. What an awesome God we have. Is that an awesome God, Mary? That is an awesome God. So now we can do the same thing. Because we have the same God as Jesus did. Remember, when Jesus came to this earth, what did he give up? How many of you? Oh, yeah. I will do this. I will. Thank you, Jesus. What is it today? The 20? Yeah, that's the 22nd. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I was just going to use this to throw at somebody. Now I can see why I'm using it. Live like Jesus. Live like Jesus. This is so good, you guys. Live like Jesus. Is Jesus your brother? When you're born again, he's your brother. Before you're born again, you're not in the family. Right? So he says, but Christ Jesus, this is Philippians 2, 7, but Christ Jesus made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. Remember, we used to be a servant. But when we came to know Jesus Christ, we're no longer servants or sons and daughters. This is by Kenneth Copeland. I really like. The truth of this verse hasn't really dawned on most people. They mistakenly think that Jesus was able to work wonders, to perform miracles, and to live above sin because he had divine powers that we wouldn't have, that we didn't have. Thus, they have never really aspired to live like he lived. We can because we've got him. Are we going to make mistakes? Absolutely. But he didn't. So he took everything for us and he gave us all the benefits, even though we mess up daily. He says, oh my, they say with great humility, I could never live like Jesus did. After all, he had advantage. He was God. They don't realize that when Jesus came to earth, he voluntarily gave up that advantage. It's like going into a fight and you give up the advantage of using your arms. His life here, not as God. Okay, he gave his life here, not as God, but as man. He had no innate supernatural powers. He had no ability to perform miracles until after he was anointed by the Holy Spirit, as it is recorded in Luke 3:22. He worked wonders, not by his own power, isn't that sweet, but by the power of the Father. Father, he said, the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Jesus didn't do the work. He was operating as a man, just like we are operating as a man. But we've got the Father, the same thing as Jesus had. Wow. And when he prayed not as the divine one who had authority as God, but as a man who walked obediently with God. And as Hebrews 5:7 says, his prayers were heard not because of his deity, but because of his reverence toward God. That's the Amplified. Jesus, the divine Son of God, set aside the privileges and powers of deity for a time and lived as a man on the earth. Once you grasp it, it will absolutely thrill your soul. Can you get that? You start walking around, you think, Jesus and I are brother and sister. Wow. Wow. We're on the same level. Wow. Kim and Tracy and Kenny Jr. are on the same level. They're all three our children. You get it? Why? Because it means that you, as a reborn child of God, filled with the same Holy Spirit as Jesus was, has the same opportunity to live as he lived on the earth. In fact, that is exactly what he intended. In John 17:18, he said to the Father, just as you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. Are you sent into the world? Just like Jesus was sent into the world. When did he get the power? When he was baptized in the Holy Ghost. When did you get the power? When you got born again. Now you don't want to be destroyed for lack of knowledge. Jesus has sent you into the world to live as he lived through the new birth. He's enabled you to exchange the sinful nature of Adam for the sinful nature of God. Sinless, sinless, sinless. I got to get that right. Let me do that again. He enabled you to exchange the sinful nature of Adam for the sinless nature of God. When you say, Jesus, come into my heart, bang. You went from a sinful nature to be a sinless nature. And you're going to heaven when you croak. He gives you the ability and the command to live above sin, to live in fellowship with the Father, to preach the gospel, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out demons, and to make disciples. How do you make disciples? I'm making disciples right here. Whenever I teach the Word of God, I'm making disciples. Because they will go out and spread the Word of God. Every time you got an act of obedience and you listen to the Holy Spirit, like our youth group is going out. Wow. You look at these children here that moved up in rank. Wow. God is good. Once you realize that you'll throw off the shackles of doubt that have held you back, you'll begin to live as Jesus meant for you to live. Not as a sin-ridden son of fallen man, but a reborn child of the Most High God. Then those around you will actually begin to see Jesus in you. Why? Some of you have said this to me. I used to say this to the Lord. Why? I'm someplace. Why do people come up and tell me their problems? Why do people come up and share things with me? And I get to pray them. Why? Because it's the Jesus in you. It's a Jesus in you. It's the Jesus in you. People will share things with you they don't share with other people. I had this happen the other night. Somebody shared something with me, and I know they didn't share it with anybody else. And I'm never going to share it with you guys. And I'm standing there going, Lord, you're just wonderful. And when I got home on Friday night, I just praise God that I could pray for that person. Do you understand what I'm saying? You get things so that you can pray. And when you pray in the Spirit, when you pray, that is God speaking through you. And God will take care of that situation, not you. So now you look at Peter and John again. What do they say? I'm going to go back to that. They fastened their eyes on him. Okay? And upon John and said, look on us. What were they looking at? They were looking at the Jesus in them. That's what they were getting him to do. Look at the one that can set you free inside of us. And he did. And he gave heed unto them. That means he did it. Expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand, and he lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankles and bones received strength. See, the Word of God can only do those things. You can't do that. Only the Word of God can set people free. When you try to set people free, when you try to do things for people when you know you're not supposed to do any, you're just getting in trouble. 8. And he leaped up, stood, and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Ooh, that had to be something else, didn't it? And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was he which sat for alms, he was poor, at the gate, at the beautiful gate of the temple, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. Is that good or is that good? God is so good, you folks. You know, do you know what brought my mother to come to my door and want Jesus Christ? You know what brought my sister, the other one who's passed on, alcoholism? What brought other family members, Dee Dee? Okay, many other ones. It was he that was in me. But do you know what they saw? They saw a big change in me. When people see that you have changed and given your heart over to Jesus Christ and you make him your Lord and Savior, he'll start cleaning you up. He'll start cleaning you up. Just like taking a little kid that comes in. Well, we used to come in from outside when we were home on the farm. You didn't take baths every day. We didn't have a bathtub. We just had the tub outside. You were probably a city slicker, so you had the tub. Didn't you have a big tub, wash tub, that sat out in the lawn?
No, we had a bathtub upstairs in the shed. We heat the water up the stove and carry it through the rooms up the stairs.
They had a bathtub upstairs.
Yeah.
They had to heat the water, take it upstairs to take a bath. We had the outside bath. I can't remember to this day what we did in the winter. It just had to be sponging it, I'm sure. But you know what? I don't think people stunk as much then as they do now because we didn't have all of the sugar. We didn't have all the crap. Because that's what really makes the people stink, you know? Oh, excuse me for that. I'll back that off a little bit. But we didn't. My mom got this deodorant. It was called Mum. I remember this little bottle, a little white bottle. Actually, it was like that white milky stuff. What is that? That glass that you can't see through it, and it's like white and milky like that. Well, I remember this traveling salesman came in. We lived on the farm over on Highway 47. And I remember standing there and watching him tell my mom about this stuff. And you could put it, it was a cream, and you could put it under your arms, and it was a deodorant. I don't know what she used before that. I don't think she ever stunk. So anyway, I remember her watching, putting that on. I remember that. Isn't that something? God supplied her need, didn't he? So now, yeah, God said, get back on it. Yes, Lord. We won't stink when we take the word of God. People will look, but people will feel the Holy Spirit coming through. And that's what will change them. My sister giving the money and trying to be the Holy Spirit to her drove her away from me. When I brought that back in and stopped that foolishness and required it back, she came back to me. So I praise God I didn't have to feel guilty when she died. It was her choice to die of alcoholism, and she did. But she knew Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. You see, they will see he that is in you. They will know he that is in you. And people will come onto you and want what you have. Do you understand that? We do. So let's stand, please. Father, I thank you. And we just have to once more play that song, Keegan. Proud to be an American. Do we have one? Do we have one where he's singing? Another YouTube where we have Lee Greenwood, where he's actually singing. We know the words pretty well. We'll give him a minute to. I am proud to be in America, an American. I like this. They said this the other day. I forget this fellow's name. He was a pastor, and he said, we are all Americans. I'm not a Holland America. You're not an African America. You're not a Spanish. We're all Americans. Yes, we come from different areas, and we can use that. We can say those things, but we are all Americans. And I am an American, and I stand because this was in God we trusted. Now, I believe it was Queen Elizabeth who supplied the money for the Pinta, Nina, and the Santa Maria supplied the money for those three ships, and Christopher Columbus headed that up and come and establish this country in God we trust. Where did she get the money from? From the Jews. That's why if we turn our back on Jews, God says he'll turn his back on us because their money established it. But their money didn't only establish it. The Jews gave us Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And now you have a Jew in you. So you can call yourself a Jew because he that is in you is greater than he that is in the world. Let's play that, please. Turn down the lights a little bit. Maybe Kim can grab the lights, huh? And turn it up nice and loud. I love it.
He's a World War II veteran. I just talked to him yesterday. Today is his birthday. He's 89 years old, and a lot of our veterans are in the audience tonight. Can I have all our veterans stand up who have also served in the military? All y'all stand up. Be proud. Men and women who have served in the military. God
Amen.
Bless you
this
all.
Is a good one. This
because
is
you're
good.
The generation that has saved it for us.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If you know the words, sing along. If you don't, still hum along.
to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause our flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men
served in the military. I want them to come up because these are the men and women that fought for us. Now Brenda's so I want you to come up and stand in place of your mother. Be obedient just like that. Come on up. And we're gonna, there is another one. Let me see what's on the sideline of that. Nice and loud. Come on in and stand with us right here. Go ahead, Keegan. Amen. Go ahead.
Tomorrow all the things were gone, worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away.
To be an American, where at least I know I'm free.
And I won't forget the man who died, who gave that life to me. And I gladly stand up
next to you
and defend her still today.
The same.
Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Good to us is he good. Who served in Iraq or Iran? Iraq. Who served? That was our latest. Tell me, just give me a little synopsis of what it meant to you to be able to serve, okay? But what are some of the things that you saw? Because remember, how were you gone overseas?
Desert Storm, but
not.
I wasn't deployed in Desert Storm. No.
Okay. So you were out of the country. You were over there. Give us a little bit. What does it smell like when you get there?
Like garbage.
That's what they all said. Give it to me now. More.
Well, you fly into Kuwait, and then you sit there and get sick because of the air quality is so poor, and you just have to assimilate to the, they call it, to being in theater. And then you get some ground training about the culture and what the security status is at the time when you're there. And then they fly you to wherever you'll be boots on the ground to serve your time.
Mm-hmm. You were out on missions. When did you go out? During the day or at night when you went out with fuel tanks?
Well, the first 6 months I was the officer in charge of a checkpoint between the Iraqi side of our base and the coalition forces side. So that I stayed behind friendly lines, if you will, on base. And the second half of my tour, I was a platoon leader, so I was in charge of convoys that would go in and around Baghdad to deliver fuel. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Was that pretty safe?
No.
No?
I guess it depends on how you look at it.
Okay. Were you shot?
I felt safe.
Yeah.
Of what I know about the Word of God, and I was tithing, so of course I knew that I was untouchable, but if you look at it in reality, no, we were shot at every time we were out. RPGs, small arms fire, yeah.
Mm-hmm. God is good. Earl, you were in Iraq. Now, you served in a different capacity. Would you tell us about that, please? Give us a little synopsis of what you guys went through for this country, for our freedom, and this flag.
I was embedded with the Iraqis. I worked with the National Police transition.
Now, do you know that? You know what that means, embedded? They lived with their enemy. Go ahead.
Well, those weren't our enemies. Those were the National Police that we were training.
Okay.
They wore the blue digits. They'd be real similar to our state police. And, you know, that's what we did. went on different missions with them and advised them. I worked with the NCOs and the Iraqi National Police. So,
did you ever have a snitch in there that you guys had to watch your backs?
The one interpreter went on leave and then never came back, and we tried to follow up. He was picked up as, as being a collaborator or whatever they determined. Before we got there, nobody had cell phones. They all had cell phones, kind of like all our teenagers now. So they all had them, and they were always on them. We never knew what they were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So, but we always knew that whenever we go through checkpoints, whenever we arrived, they always somehow knew we were going to be there. So,
mm-hmm. Was it comfortable where you stayed?
No. One of the luxuries we had was I was given a couple cell phones that, to this day, I don't know who paid that bill, but I was always able to call Kim as long as we were around in Baghdad. Once we were outside Baghdad, we weren't able to, then we had a sat phone. A couple times we stayed down by a place called Salmon Park, and there was just our 10-man team, that's it. And there was, my opinion, our Iraqi battalion commander was as crooked as the day is long, but that's what saved us, because if it was bad and we came in that area, then it would be within a couple weeks, it was always better. So he was always doing something, because we could, walk around nonchalant, but like we'd go to the next place over, and they're like, holy crap, don't walk like that. You got to hide,
mm-hmm.
because you're getting shot at.
Did you lose a Humvee one time? Did it go over? Didn't it, when you were going on a road and the bridge went out or something, or some of it?
Yeah, the bank gave way. We dumped a Humvee. We had the one that was just, they rebuilt the whole thing, and it still didn't work. But, I don't know why, and then we looked at the history, because they all have a history, but yeah, that one tipped over and we had to have it pulled out, which did not make, the active duty commander in the area very happy.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah.
Where were you when that tipped over? Were you on top? Were you in it?
First, I had tried backing it up, and then one of our NCOs who drives UPS truck figured he was a better driver than me, and he didn't find it. He found out that, no, he wasn't, so.
Mm-hmm.
But what actually happened was we were driving down, and usually what happened when we'd go on a mission with the Iraqis, we'd dismount as many as we could safely dismount, which means anybody that wasn't a driver or a gunner, and then everybody else would walk, which, I did both, and so we're trying to stay up with them, with comms and whatnot, and they're going through the country, and we're trying to stay on the roads with them, and we just ended up driving down this road into a dead end, and we had to back up all the way around this fish pond on top of that berm, and that berm is what gave away. So.
Oh, dear. But no one was hurt?
No.
But your camera was lost?
Yeah, it ended up in the water.
Yeah.
In that ditch, so.
Mm-hmm. But you made it through. Is God good? Thank you, people. Yep. I appreciate this. But Father God, we are so blessed. We are blessed because men and women served. And you look at World War II and Korea, you look at all of these. They served. And for this country to go down is not right. Mark God's word, because God says there are great things that are going to happen in this country, because when it's ruled by God, it prospers. And God is working through this man. He is a born-again, spirit-filled president. Praise God, who loves God with all his heart. So, Father, we thank you so much. Now, I plead the blood of Jesus over each and every one here. And I thank you, Father God, for increase. And now, Father, I also thank you for these men and women who served and those that aren't here. that have served. I just praise you, Father God. And I thank you that President Donald J. Trump is going to increase our military, and we're going to have the best military in the whole world. We're going to get military people that are going to get paid instead of always taking things away from them. They will be taken care of so wonderfully. I thank you for that, Father, in the precious name of Jesus. Now, Father God, I also give you the Packer game today. And I thank you, Father God, for the Packers win in Jesus' name. Do you agree? Yes. Amen. God bless you all. You have a wonderful day. Amen. Thank you guys for coming up. I appreciate that.